So now we turn to Mr. Narayanan, who is the last, but we know, of course, that means he is the first. So please.
Sure.
Yeah.
Who is going to further expand our agenda as though it didn't need further expansion.
Thank you, Marcus. It's a privilege to be here at the 10th World Policy Conference. And special thanks to Monsieur Thierry for the stewardship of the WPC in these very fractured times. The last speaker has some advantages and some disadvantages. Much of what I would like to say has been covered, but I've been assured by Marcus that I can take in a couple of extra minutes if it comes to that. So, from what we have just heard from the previous speakers, one thing is obvious, that the shift in the geopolitical center of gravity from the Euro-Atlantic to the Indo-Pacific, further overshadowed by the rise of China, has led to a very significant churn in relationships and events in Asia. Today, most of the rivalries in Asia are being played out in Northeast Asia, the Indo-Pacific, the so-called AFPAC region, and West Asia. Asia may today be an area of economic growth, but the truth is that many of the old sources of stability in Asia have broken down. Earlier ideological divisions have weakened, no doubt, but religious orthodoxy, radical Islamist ideology, and the terror imperative have become more marked. We've heard a lot just now about what's happening in North Korea, so I don't have to dilate on that at any point, excepting to say that all of us agree that North Korea poses one of the gravest threats seen to peace in the region and beyond than any other one. We also heard a lot about what's happening in East Asia and to some extent Southeast Asia. I only want to say that most of us in Asia are concerned about where China stands. It's a great civilization. But there is an impression that China wishes to exert its authority, its insists on its exceptionalism and its uniqueness. And most nations, particularly in East and Southeast Asia, are concerned as to where China is headed. The 19th Party Congress did little to assuage such concerns. And following China's announcement of its great power ambitions, its projection as a military and economic superpower, and especially the contents on President Xi's Make China Great Again speech has added to these concerns. But I'm here basically to speak about troubles in South Asia and West Asia. South Asia, Afghanistan in South Asia, is today one of the most troubled regions, not only in Asia, but across the world. Afghanistan may be in South Asia, but I think it is the heart of Asia. The situation here is extremely fragile. The elected government in Afghanistan has lost control over much of the countryside, almost 40%, perhaps even more. None of the other groups that are present in Afghanistan can claim any control, any large-sized control over areas and territories. The most distinctive aspect of Afghanistan is the degree of violence that is present there. I don't think it's being reflected to the same extent as I think we should, at least what people of us who live in South Asia and perhaps Southeast Asia are aware of. Today, the so-called Afghan Taliban, the Haqqani network, the ISIS, that is the Islamic State, apart from several other terrorist groups indigenous to Afghanistan, such as the Hizb-e-Islami and the Harkat-ul-Ilahi Islami, They are the defining aspect of Afghanistan. The elected government counts for much less than the actual degree of violence that is taking place. Almost on an average, a minimum of about 30 to 40 people are being killed in Afghanistan, and this does hardly find much mention there. Achieving peace in Afghanistan is entirely dependent on getting the Afghan Taliban to the negotiating table. This can be achieved only through the exercise of force. Without the Afghan Taliban agreeing to accept some of the conditions for talks, no peace can exist. At the same time, you can't do that to the exclusive thing of only the Taliban, because there is the ISIS specter, or the Islamic State specter, which has to be there. So we have a conflict of priorities as far as the region is concerned. I assure you that the situation is extremely complex and complicated. The occasional increase in troops, the lessening of troops, etc., has not added to the situation, had not brought any more measure to the situation. There are efforts being made for peace in Afghanistan. There is a Pakistan-led quadrilateral coordination group, which includes the United States and China, apart from Pakistan and Afghanistan. But it is not making any headway. Last month, the quadrilateral meeting held, but 2 days after the meeting was held, there were two devastating attacks in Afghanistan. There is another one which is being organized by the Shanghai Cooperation Organization, the contact group, that is also meeting with the same unfortunate fate. Michael mentioned about two other critical areas of conflict in South Asia. One is, of course, the Pakistan-India imbroglio, which is going on. I agree that there are tensions in between the two countries. The situation has, to some extent, deteriorated in the past 2 years. But I think there is a great deal of restraint on both sides, and I would like to assure this House that the possibility of a major conflict or a confrontation is not present. It is present, it is an ever-present reality, but I think the leadership on both sides is aware of the nature of the threat and the seriousness of that threat. There was a reference Michael also made to the China-India conflict. I was the special representative for border talks with China during the years as a national security advisor. We have differences. We have a very long border. There are difficulties across the border. But I can assure you that a conflict, an open conflict, other than border incursions and border kinds, is out of the question. We recently had a standoff at a place called Doklam, which it is in Bhutan, on the trijunction between Bhutan, India, and China. And I can assure this House that both India and China are conscious of the complications that can arise if they go beyond certain state. There will be tensions, but the tensions will be maintained. So I think China-India border problem is not something that we need to be concerned as a long term. That there's a clash between two civilizations, and I think that will continue. I do think there was no mention here about West Asia, and I think that is an area which requires a great deal of attention, because four of the countries in the world which have the largest Muslim populations are in Asia. Indonesia, Bangladesh, Pakistan, India. So what happens in West Asia, particularly not so much maybe the clashes as much as the ideological clash that is taking place between Sunni Saudi Arabia and Shiite Iran, creating the possibility of a basic divide down the middle, has potential for countries which have large Muslim populations. The Shia-Sunni balance is something that I think we need to. We are in Morocco here. We are on the periphery of the region. It is something that is going to remain with us for some time. It has implications which are not too obvious at this moment. It is not going to be confined to to West Asia. It is going to be much beyond that. The Qatar standoff with Saudi Arabia is an instance in point of this kind. There is also another aspect. The ISIS is facing some setbacks in areas like Syria and Iraq and whatnot. But do remember that as the ISIS is so-called suppressed in this region, their stormtroopers are moving across the rest of the world. We need to be aware that Michael touched on this point, that terrorism will be magnified as a result of an excessive pressure that has been applied here. There's also the aspect that as ISIS weakens, other forces are emerging in this area. The Kurds, for instance, are trying to redraw the boundaries of some of the countries. I do believe that the next phase of the struggle in West Asia may be determined by who controls the territory once held by the ISIS. But do remember that notwithstanding whatever is happening in terms of the conflict between countries, the ideology and appeal of radicalized Islamist movements, especially the ISIS and Al-Qaeda, remains unaffected. One word of caution. If the Iran nuclear deal were to unravel, I think we'll have a new area of tensions arising in the region. The implications of this, I think, I wish we could have a special session on that. What I would like to stress is that Asian security today, one of the speakers said that things are better. My assessment is that Asian security today is in a state of flux. There are major centers of violence that have emerged. There's West Asia, which I briefly touched on. There is Afghanistan, which I dealt with in a little more detail. There are problems across in parts of Southeast Asia where nations are concerned about the rise of China's ambitions. And of course, there are the conflicts in East Asia itself, the South China Sea, East China Sea. Thank you very much.